To 2 Timothy, the third chapter, and just pick up verse 16 and 17. Exodus, the 17th chapter, verse 8 through 13. I am doing everything I can to hold myself together.
All right,
every tea kettle should whistle at least once in a while. And every Christian should have a testimony that just percolates in you. Every once in a while, there should be something that God has done that you can't even talk about it. Oh, he should have been good to more than just two folk up in here. I'm trying to get through here. You're going to have to excuse me because God's been good to me. Talking about yesterday and yesteryear. God's been good to me today. Oh, I found the psalmist that he merely said, this is the day that the Lord has made. Oh, he did his part. Now my part, I will rejoice and be glad. Oh, you guys, I'm trying to keep my cool up in here. I got on this road, my wife bought it. I'm trying to look dignified, but when I think about the goodness of God and what he's done for me, my soul cries out. It don't take much for me. I don't apologize for it. I wish you could get to the place that you could claim God not has been, but God is good to me. Exodus, the 17th chapter, verse 8 through 13. Help me, Holy Spirit. You selected it, so I'm going to try to deal with it a little bit. It said, Then came Amalek and fought with Israel at Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, Choose us out men and go out and fight with Amalek tomorrow. I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. Watch what Joshua did. So Joshua did. Oh God, I wish I had a Joshua up in here. Joshua did as Moses had said to him. And fought with Amalek, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass when Moses held up his hand, the Israelites prevailed, and when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and they took a stone and put it under him. And he sat thereon, and Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands.
Yes, they did.
The one on the one side and the other on the other side.
Come on,
tell somebody, get on your side.
Get on your side.
I'm going to be on my side. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun.
All right.
And Joshua discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. Said he did some cutting. Now let me see if I can help you of how we can get there. Just two verses. Paul talking to Timothy. And as he was closing this third chapter. He said all scripture. Even the ones you don't like. Even the ones you tore out the book. Even the ones you scratched out. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Here's the good part for those who believe that. And it's profitable for doctrine. This is the part you won't like. For reproof. You're really not going to like this. For correction. Most of us don't like for instruction. And most of us can't stay in righteousness. Verse 17 closes. He said that the man of God, Zion Hill, you look here. Bethlehem, you look there. Rising stars, you look over there. Some of y'all are too hard-headed even to do that, but I'm going to talk about it anyway. That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Before you sit down, I want to pose a question. Who will give the pastor a hand? Who will give the pastor a hand? I done listened to singing and enjoyed it. I haven't eaten, but I will enjoy that shortly. To this great culinary staff, to this great church under the leadership of my brother in this clarion call to tell dying men and women that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. My brother in this struggle, Reverend Booker T. Lewis, I want to say thank you for the invite to his most beautiful wife. It's good to see you. To these fellow clarion callers from a hill called Calvary, it's good to be here with you. The commentary is still the same. We will, before we leave here, find a way to the Via Dolorosa. Somebody ought to hear me. There's no sense in standing up if you're not pointing men to the Via Dolorosa. There's no sense in calling it preaching if Calvary isn't involved in it. Reverend, I stood at the door of dilemma looking at your scripture and think the Lord dropped me off where I can prayerfully meet that before I close. I want to pose the question, who will give the pastor a hand? But that's not the tag nor the title that I want to talk about. I do want to ask the question, who? While he attempts to get us back on track, I want to encourage you with the topic of subject of make the book talk. Reverend, if you want to find folk that's going to hold up your hands, you got to make the book talk. We've heard enough rhetorical communication from man. It's time to make the book talk. Oftentimes in the church setting, there are some, not all, who believe the pastor is supposed to do everything. They want him to teach, preach, sing, cook, visit the incarcerated, run the men's ministry, the women's ministry, run the missionary ministry, officiate choir fights, intervene with usher incidents, run all the ministries in the church, change the light bulbs, cut the grass, settle fights in the pews, parking lots, interpret your dreams and agree with your hunches, figure out how to pay bills when you won't pay tithes. Well, I thought I was back home until I looked up. Excuse me. I forgot I'm in Fresno and I don't want no problems up in here. Wanting to stand by the bedside of aging and stricken member that cannot understand when their spouse comes to church.
Come on, preacher.
Upset. You want us to do all of this and then you want to wonder why Tish looks so strange at some of you.
Come on,
I don't know about Tish, but I can tell you I didn't have to interpret Sister Hodge's dreams. I can share with you our conversations. You can't bother me without upsetting her. There's absolutely nothing wrong with the because he is trying to do everything in the church. He comes home at times after being neglected by the folks he's serving. Some of you would rather hug a snake and kiss a scorpion than support your pastor. We must continue to serve folk who stand face to face, curse at you while you're praying for them. Listen to members tell you, you treat that family better than you treat them. There's a very delicate balance that must be achieved as we try to move this thing along. As a matter of fact, if you want to know what the pastor's job is, you can look in Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verses 11 and 12. The Bible said he gave some apostles and some prophets, some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. And the work is for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Our job is to get you in the position to serve God and not serve yourself. Somebody ought to say amen. My brothers and sisters, as we examine the text, we see the children of Israel.
Yes, sir.
They have just been refreshed by the water from the rock.
Yeah.
And as soon as it seems like it's smooth sailing, trouble arises. Has that ever happened to you?
Yeah.
Right after you believe it's smooth sailing, everything looked right. It's a few brothers up in here say, I remember that on my wedding day. It looked like I was going to be in bliss, but before the brothers talked too loud, and some sister said, if I done knew what that booger had in plan. Oh, I wouldn't have changed my name. I'd have changed my direction. Oh, the storm clouds come out of nowhere, and storms can be unpredictable. What starts out as a spring shower can turn into a major flood. Back home, what seemed like a few flurries can turn into a storm and escalate into a major snowstorm. And you never know how long the storm will last. And I don't care who you are and how much money you have in the bank. I don't care how smart you are. There are three types of people.
Come on, Bridget.
There are people that are in the storm. Those are the ones that will take help from any and everybody. There are some folk who are coming out the storm, and when they show up at church, they're on fire for the Lord. Then it's a few of you, the Lottie Dottie, looking for a party group. You always moving somewhere, but I stop by to tell you, on the way to Rodale, you're not in the storm. You're not coming out, but you're headed for a storm. Oh, the Bible said, man born of woman is of a few days and they are filled. Oh, there are storm clouds on the horizon. Not all trouble is to mess you up. Some is to push you back on course. It's about three folk up in here that can be honest and say, if I wouldn't have got in trouble, I wouldn't have bowed down and turned my life over to Jesus. It was trouble that I couldn't get out of. It was trouble that mama couldn't help me with. Daddy couldn't help. Oh, I had to turn it over to the Lord, and he worked it out. Some of us have been in dry places, couldn't find water, and God took you to the oasis of life. Well, I stopped by to tell you that Jesus will make a way.
He said,
don't worry about trouble. He let us know, Jesus said, in the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Not Buddha, not Elijah Muhammad, not Dionne Warwick and the psychic network, but Jesus Christ, the living God, is a bridge over troubled water. He's a shelter in the midst of a storm. Do I have two or three folk that can walk with me as the children of Israel were refreshing themselves Somebody say trouble.
Trouble.
Showed up in Amalek. He came and he fought with them at Rephidim. Have you ever known somebody who's not happy unless there's some mess going on? They criticize everything. One time two saints was in the sanctuary talking. They seen another saint break through the door, and the new saint looked at the older saint and said, where is he going? Say, he's headed for a storm. Say, how do you know? Because he said, if it's not one, he'll bring one with him. Do you know two or three, four? Every time they show up, trouble is coming in the door with them. I need a couple folks who are forecasters and meteorologists that can say there's a storm on the horizon. But I got a God that walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me that I'm his own. I got to have a God that shows up in the middle of my storm. I got a God that walks on the stormy seas of my life, and he says, peace. Oh, you must know something about it. Oh, he merely says, peace, be still. Moses tells Joshua, choose out men and go out and fight with Amalek. And it's here that we are introduced to Joshua. And notice with me, the Bible does not record any arguments about who was going to do the job. Oh, you missed that. That you'll catch on the way home. There was no argument, no disagreement, and it does not say Moses had to consult with any boards or committees. Oh, you're mad at me, but I got a bus waiting to take me home, and I'm all right. I got a few folks that'll help me out if I get up in trouble in here, but I stopped to check. I'm not asking no board nothing. Every December, every mission, every leader of the church has to submit a commitment letter.
All right.
And they have to come and say, I'm not committed to you, Pastor. You too low on the commitment level. I'm going to commit to God. And then because I commit to God, I'm going to commit to God's church. And because one Friday, he sent me somewhere I didn't want to be, and I wound up in Rodeo. So when you commit to God and you commit to his church, you, oh, shucks now, you got to commit to me. Oh, you don't like it. But the Bible says, obey them that have rule over you.
Moses,
let me get back to Moses. Y'all ready to fight up in here? One of my deacons took a nap. Stay woke, or they might come up. Let them get it. Deacon, don't let nobody come up this aisle here. Moses chooses out the men. He sends Joshua as the man, and he allows him to choose the men to go and fight. Watch this. When God gives the pastor the vision to tell you to go, it's not your job to start telling him the 1,000 reasons why you can't. For my Bible said, greater is he. Somebody should be getting energized right now. I'm waiting on a call from my pastor, because if he tells me, God said it, and I'm going to do it. Somebody ought to hear me up here. I'm tired of all these cowardly, lily-livered saints. Can't never stand up to anything. Fall for everything. Sending more money to TD Jakes. T.D. Jakes sermons and you got your pastor, sir. But when trouble comes, T.D. Jakes not showing up. Bishop Paul Warren not coming to your house. Y'all watching the preachers of L.A. and should be working with the preacher in Fresno. Moses commissioned Joshua to carry out the task of selecting the men for battle. He goes on and he allows him to do what he's charged him to do. Help yourself, Reverend, because I need help here.
Yes.
Too often I tell folk to do something and I spend more time watching you than... I need some folk that when I give you a task, that you move so fast that I can go and work somewhere else for me. We can get much more done if you haven't have to convince you and coerce you and pray with you and fast with you and all those other things. Every once in a while, just say, aye, Captain, I'm on the way. If God said it, I'll do it. When the pastor commissions you to carry out a task, do your best with your own ability. For my Bible says, your gift shall make room for you. God has already revealed it to the pastor that you can do the job. Don't operate in the spirit of fear at the church all the time. We're going to learn how to do what God has called us to do. And notice Moses said, choose us out men. He didn't say, go get your friends and your family. Some of the work can't get done because you're trying to take your family where God didn't tell them to go. Some of the best work I did with folk I didn't like because we got the job done. We didn't honeymoon all day long. We didn't sit up talking about the pastor and his wife. And let me stick a pin in it real quick. Moses, if he could show up, he would tell you it's dangerous to talk about the pastor's wife. He would tell you that God intervenes in all of your text messages, all of your whispering, all of your email. God will show up in the middle of, and God had a remedy when you talk about the man of God's wife. He stopped by Aaron and he stopped by Miriam and he said, I'm going to mark you that everybody know you are a gossiper. Some of y'all are marked as gossipers. Guess what you got to do to get it fixed? You got to go see the pastor and let pastor pray for you. I'm ready to pray for some of you. I know you're talking about her, but I'm praying for you. That's the reason they said, and God will see you, but I will pray for you. In order to get some of this stuff right, some of y'all got to go see pastor. Amen. We see the leprosy on you, baby boy. Baby girl, I noticed it. It's not green like jealousy, it's white like leprosy. Moses, I'm pulling the pin out of that because y'all looking at me real funny now. Some funny looks coming up in here. Moses said, tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. He didn't say he would be in the midst of the war, but on the mountaintop. I can hear some of the saints up in here right now say, why he need to be up there? Why ain't he down here with us? We down here fighting and he up there looking. What he think he gonna do from up there? But when God told him, he knew where to place him so that we could win. The reason we can't win is because some of y'all pulling us down off of the mountain. I got to come down there and check on you. See why y'all down there fighting each other instead of fighting with enemy. I can hear some of the day saints say, he don't need to be up there. Who he think he is? He just a man like me. Well, let me tell you, with your good-looking self, that's a half-truth. And Dickmar said a half-truth is a whole lie. He's not a man like you. Jeremiah will show up in the first chapter, verse 5, and say, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee. And I adorned thee to be a prophet. And in today's language, that's the pastor. The pastor is God's man. Be careful how you treat him. Keep your mouth off of him. And don't put your hands on him. The body of Christ is made up of different parts, and each part is important as the next. Nobody's telling you the pastor's more important than you. He just has a different responsibility than you. Somebody ought to say amen up in here. If we came to the house of prayer on one accord, one mind to worship Jesus, one mind to serve him, to lift him up together. Before a lost and dying world, people would be saved. People would be delivered and God's people would be blessed. So Joshua did as Moses said unto him, and he fought with Amalek, and Moses and Aaron and Hur went up on the top of the hill. Some of you fighting with the wrong folks too, but I wish I had time to tell you about that. That's the reason you need directions from the pastor. Some of y'all fighting with the wrong people. The reason we can't win the outside war, we got too many internal battles. God has equipped us to do battle and to have power of the gospel. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is power of God unto salvation. To everyone that believeth, we have power. Somebody say power.